gentlemen, welcome. Look, I have a couple announcements for you. Everyone take a seat and we're going to get started here. I have a couple announcements for you. First of all, we have a concert happening here on February 20th. Natalie Merchant will be here on the stage February 20th on this stage. Tickets are available through Ticketmaster and the box office here. We also have a couple other things we want you to know. First of all, for those folks that did know this, but you should have, this is not a concert tonight. It's an evening with Billy Joel, an evening where you can ask questions. He will answer those questions, and he'll sing a little bit tonight. Now, you'll notice around here, you'll notice that there are some people with mics in the audience. Raise your hands if you have mics. And during the show, you'll be able to ask questions, so think of some things. We want you to ask one question, just one question, so everyone can get a chance if they'd like to ask a question, all right? We also want to tell you there's no autographs tonight, no tapes. Don't be bringing stuff up to the stage. Just stay in your seats, enjoy the show. Right now, I'd like to introduce to you Billy Joel.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.
There she goes, Miss America.
Thank you so much. I hope to use my beauty to bring peace to mankind.
Okay, so, Long Island, yeah, okay. Okay, well, now, I hope no one here is under the illusion that this is gonna be some kind of, you know, unplugged concert, you know. I'm a piano player, so I'm already unplugged. The only way I'm gonna get any more unplugged is with a big laxative, okay? So. This is hopefully an evening of questions, answers, if there are students here who have questions about composition, lyric writing, piano playing, being in the music business, aspects of the music industry, questions about aspects of celebrity, maybe would-be journalists. Anyone with a curiosity about the job that I do, because I am doing these kinds of things to try to bring forth the idea that this is actually a gig. It's not, I don't go home at night and think, I am a rock star. Who's that guy who does that? The Martin Short does this sometimes. I've done this at colleges all around the world, actually. I've done this at Oxford. I spoke at Oxford. I did a lecture at Oxford, right? I'm standing in the Oxford Union Lecture Hall, and behind me they have pictures of Gandhi, you know, Winston Churchill, you know. And I'm thinking, what the hell am I doing up here? They asked me. So, Harvard I've been to, Harvard. Princeton, all them fancy schmancy schools, and I'm here. Actually, I played at Post back in the 70s before the dome collapsed. I don't know how many people remember that. It was called the dome. It wasn't called the Tillies, so it was called the dome, and it was just a matter of time before the roof fell in. I played here back then, and I actually didn't graduate high school with my high school class. I was supposed to graduate in 67, and I didn't go to school enough the last year or two of high school. I went to the end of high school, and they said, you didn't show up enough. And I said, well, I passed the test. And they said, no, you got to go to summer school. I said, I put in my 12 years. of indentured servitude in this public school system, and I'm not going another day. And my mother, you know, it broke her heart because she wanted me to have a high school diploma. And I said, and graduate, and she, you know, she was sad about it. And I said, don't worry, Mom. I'm gonna take care of things. I'll take care of you. So things worked out all right. So she's here tonight to see how I'm doing in my new career as a professor, a Professor Joe.
And so?
So I've done a number of these things. Now I will play some songs, and I will use these instruments to illustrate points about music that I've written, music that I like, music that you might be interested in, because this is part of the gig. This is part of what I do. I'm a composer who ended up being a rock star, which I think is kind of funny, actually, because I didn't. In the 60s, I wanted to be a rock star. When I was in these bands, the Lost Souls, the Hassles. Anybody remember the Hassles? Yeah, there's a couple old farts here tonight. And then I went on to be a writer, and I decided to be a songwriter in the era of the, quote, singer-songwriter. Early 70s, you know, James Taylor, Joni Mitchell, Carly Simon, Jackson Brown, Carole King, all these great singer-songwriters were having this huge success. So they said, well, you're a songwriter, why don't you make your own album? So I said, okay. And then I made an album. It wasn't very good. It wasn't produced very well. And they said, well, now that you've made the album, you go out on the road and you will promote the album and tour. I said, okay. And I went out on the road, and I'm out on the road and became like Billy Joel. And I'm talking to disc jockeys who are, you know, some of the very strange people, disc jockeys are. And I'm sitting there thinking, well, this is a weird way to be a writer, you know? But it all became grist for the mill. So what I'm going to do is open up the evening to questions. If you have a question, I'll try to point you out so that you know it's you I'm pointing to. And if you stand up, there are people with wireless microphones all around the room, and they will pass the microphone down to you, ask the question. Please try to keep it like a one-part question. Some people do these cheap tricks, and they ask like five-part questions. Do me a favor. Don't ask me to start signing autographs. I start signing an autograph, and then it's like, Billy Joel, all that, Billy Joel. You know, you think you get a kick out of it. But the first time I signed an autograph, it was like, somebody wants my autograph. Billy Joel. And now it looks like, you know. But it takes up a lot of time. And do me a favor also. I know some of you may have tapes of songs, and you may want me to hear them. Look, I'm not a record company, so I'm not going to put out your record. I write my own music, so I really don't need you to write music for me. And I'm not a critic. And so if you give me something because you want my opinion, even if I think it stinks, I'm not going to tell you it stinks. I'm going to go, really good, man. Good luck. Lots of luck. Because I've heard some stuff that I thought was awful by some very big names, and I was brought up to be polite. And if you have nothing nice to say, don't say it. Unless you're with, like, really close friends, you know. So, and the other thing is I get sued all the time, you know. And I don't want to get sued anymore. You know, we sent you a tape. Well, a letter from a lawyer. My client sent you a tape and used the word the in his song, and we noticed in your last album you used the word the 1,500 times. Therefore, we are ba 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 ba, and you will appear in court. And they actually, you know, you got to do it. You got to fight these things. And even if you win, you're out the money, and the lawyers are all happy. They run away with little bags of money. We love the music business, you know. So I'm sure there are law students here. Nothing personal, okay? But I don't want to get sued anymore, so don't give me your tapes. Actually, if you try to give me a tape, I got a whole bunch of witnesses who are going to see me, like, kick it. You know what I mean? So anyway, I will now open the room to questions. I'll try to get all around the room, so we're going to bring up the house lights. That way I can see This is the cue to bring up the house lights. This would be a house lighting style cue. There we go, okay. He takes off the scarf, he must mean business. So, even in the back of the room, I will try to go wherever I can to, okay. There's a gentleman all the way in the back waving his hands frantically. Must have something extremely, no. I'm talking about the back, man. I'm talking about, like, Medford, you know? Coram. Middle Island, you know, one of those. Can they get a microphone to him? Yeah? Okay, let's see if this works. Don't hit it.
Doesn't work.
Hi, you Hello? Have to speak up, though. How come I'm hearing bop, bop, bop? There you go.
It's him.
It's me.
I wanted to say thank you very much for picking me first. I listened to all the rules that you laid out. It's him again. And this falls in between all the cracks. I have about 17,000 questions I wanted to ask you. So. And I checked this with my girlfriend, and it's fine. I was hoping we could maybe invite you to dinner at the house, because we live in Bohemia, and...
Oh, I wasn't far off then. Right.
No, not at all.
Okay.
And failing that, I wanted to ask you a quick question about... You don't have to answer me now, by the way. I'll send my address up. You had a very long association with one single producer, and I try and read everything and listen to everything you say, not everything, but what do you think about that? You haven't said much about Phil Ramone, kind of parted ways and have done great stuff since then, but I'm sure everybody here loves the early stuff, and he had a lot to do with that from The Stranger on, and do you miss work?
Do I miss working with Phil Ramone?
Yeah.
Okay, good question. Okay. Now, you live in Bohemia. I'm assuming that's not the European Bohemia because they have, I would go to dinner there. They have great beer, Bohemian beer, and sausage. And but then again, Hitler came from that area, so Bohemia. Bohemian food. You're near the airport, right? Islip Airport, Bohemia. That's where all those auto shops are and shit. Bohemia. All right. Well, how do I feel about having worked with Phil Ramone? I did a lot of albums with Phil, starting in 1977 with The Stranger. Phil Ramone had been, before I worked with him, somebody who was a well-known engineer. He wasn't credited as a producer. He had worked on a lot of albums, Sinatra, Paul Simon, Streisand, and all these crazy rock and roll bands as an engineer. And I wanted to work with Phil in 77 because he was an engineer. He was also, very few people know this, he was a child prodigy. He was a violinist. He was a child prodigy, and at 12 he was doing concerts on the violin, and he probably hated it. He doesn't talk about it at all. But he's got great musical instincts. And I worked with Phil up until the bridge. Up to the, yes, thank you. Which is like 86. So it was like 77 to 86. So it's just about 10 years. What happened was, and I love Phil Ramone, and I loved working with Phil Ramone, and I may work with Phil again because I have so much respect for the man. And I know that there are people who like the earlier stuff, and I get this all the time. Why don't you do another album like The Stranger? I said, because I already did an album like The Stranger. It was called The Stranger, you know. Why don't you do another album like Piano Man? Like what? Like Piano Grandson? Piano piano grandfather, you know, why don't you do another album like 104th Street? You know, I don't like to repeat myself. I have an attention span that's about this long, and that's why I forgot what I was going to say. Okay, so Phil Ramone. So I got to a point on this album, The Bridge. I was doing this album, The Bridge, and even the guys, between me and the guys in the band, it wasn't gelling. We weren't enjoying it anymore. It was becoming like a treadmill. Here we were, back in the studio, okay, time to make another album. All righty then, we'll make an album. And then Phil and I had been together, and in ways it was like having a relationship with someone that's a love affair, and it's passionate, and it's hot, and it's great, and it's sexy, and all that stuff. And after 10 years, it's kind of like, what do you want to do? You want to watch TV, or you want to mess around? It's difficult, you know. You gotta keep the passion going. And I think Phil and I had gotten to a point where we needed to do something different. And I haven't commented on a lot, actually, because I haven't been asked a lot about it. This is one of the few times I've actually been asked. I probably will do another project with Phil Ramone because I love him so much and I respect him so much, and I like the work that we did in the past. And it's, I just don't know exactly what project we'll end up doing. But I've worked with other producers since then. Mick Jones, who was this crazy English guy, who was fun to work with, and then Danny Korchmar, who was not a lot of fun to work with, but is a very talented guy in his own way. So you have to keep doing different things. You got to keep moving along as an artist. I don't know what I'm going to do next. I have no idea what I'm going to do next. And maybe it'll be with Phil, maybe it'll be with somebody else. But when I get to the point where it's time for me to walk to a studio, that's when I'll know. But anyway, thank you for that question. So let me go down to this area. So, because we were way back there, so we're going to be very democratic about this, and we're going to choose some of the more privileged people here who somehow cheap tricked their seats. Okay, yeah, right here. Yeah, this young woman right here in the... Right, okay.
Hi.
Hi. Wait, is this working? Can you hear it? Try it again.
Hi.
Can you hear that? Okay.
How you doing? I heard about a project with the CD-ROM that you were doing. I don't know what it is, but I wanted to know if you could explain it. Okay.
I have been asked if I want to do a CD-ROM project that has something to do with this type of format. I'm not sure if it's going to work because my understanding is, and I'm computer illiterate, okay? I'm completely computer illiterate. I went out and I got one of those little laptop jobs because everybody in the road crew and the band all of a sudden had a computer. One year, everybody had this little Mac, and they're on their plane, and they're all tapping away. And then I said, nobody's talking to me anymore, you know? Now, I understand that the CD-ROM is like, you can drop all these things into the CD-ROM like a... Somebody asked me a question about Phil Ramone. The answer will already be in the CD-ROM, and they'll have illustrations and some film footage and all kinds of eye candy and stuff. But it won't be live. It will be pre-programmed. That's right. And is that the CD-ROM? Now I got a problem with that because that's not live. That's not spontaneous. As a matter of fact, I have a problem with what's called a live album. How can it be live if it's an album? It's like jumbo shrimp, you know? You know? I'm putting out a live album. Oh, okay. I'm just confused with some of the, it's like interactive. Like, what we're having tonight is like interactive. Hey, we're being interactive, you know? Yeah. Okay, so didn't people do that before they had like TV and computers? Didn't they interact? Didn't they have intercourse? You know, wasn't there like interaction? So the CD-ROM thing, I understand conceptually what the technology is. I yet have to see one that I go, oh yeah, I want to do that. You know what I mean? It's like people ask me if I want a Billy Joel comic book, you know? Hey, we got a kid. We got this idea, Billy Joel Comics, okay? And we're going to call you Piano Man. You're going to fly around with a big cape, you know? And you're going to rescue music students from bad teachers, you know? Nah, I don't want to do that. The other day, they sent me, some merchandising company sent me Billy Joel wine. I swear to God, I got this fancy case. I said, what the hell is this? It must be a late Christmas present. Right? I open it up, and there's like my face on a bottle of wine. Like, hey, let's splurge and let's order the Billy Joel stuff, okay? Why? Who would buy this crap? You know what I mean? I would get, you know, cold duck before I would order Billy Joel wine. And then another company, hey, we did the Sinatra tomato sauce. And we're Billy Joel tomato sauce. Just, why would anybody buy Billy Joel tomato sauce? It's not even an Italian name, you know? Well, look at Paul Newman. He's doing all right, you know? Yeah, you're right. But I never bought it, you know? It all goes to charity.
Yeah, okay.
So, to answer the question, technically, I don't know if I'm going to license the CD-ROM project. I got a little problem with it because until somebody who is as computer illiterate as me can really understand the purpose of it, I'm in a holding pattern, okay? So that's the answer to that. So, now I've been over here. I've been in the back. It's right in the front. Yeah, right here. Okay.
I was just wondering, the songs that you write about your daughter and from around the island, if they come naturally to you, or if you sit there and think, I want to write a song about my daughter, like, is it hard to do? Like, do you just think, all right, I'm just going to write a song about my daughter and just do it, or does it just, like, come naturally to you?
Okay.
And then you go from there.
A fair enough question. Let me use one of these things to illustrate. I actually wrote a song about my daughter a long time ago. Well, not a long time ago, right after she was born. Now, this is a book with all the lyrics in it that I wrote, because I wrote enough songs now and I'm starting to forget, all right? I'm not gonna lie about it. Now, I could bullshit you and have a teleprompter and you wouldn't have any idea. A teleprompter, this thing I used on the Elton John tour. Elton John has a teleprompter. Now, a teleprompter is essentially a television set with words on it. So I'd be, you know, and it's his song, so why the hell should I know the lyrics to his song? So I watch TV.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside. I wanna do, yeah. Easily hide.
I always kind of cringed when I did this part.
I don't have much money, but if I did, I'd buy a big house.
And I would never look at Elton when I sang this song.
Where we both could live.
And then he'd start singing.
If I was a sculptor. Then again, no.
But the thing is, you get hooked on this teleprompter. It's a TV set. So during my own show, I'd be, you know, like, I'd be singing, oh, what's one of the songs I would sing? Let me just find something, and I would do. I don't even remember that set anymore. Oh, Scenes from the Timer. Okay, Scenes from the Timer. Okay, so. On TV are my lyrics.
A bottle of wine, a bottle of red, perhaps a bottle of rosé and
Twisted, which I would never write now because I can't stand Rosé. But Billy Joel Rosé, okay. We'll get a table near the street. This is cool, I'm on TV. In my familiar place, you and I, that's right, I'm on TV. My words have their own TV show. A bottle of red, there it is. A bottle of white, no commercials, no nothing. It's just you're on TV. So, and I got used to this, so I said, no, I don't want to do that. I want to do it in a way so I can somewhat still have to think. And so who did I go to? I go to Bob Dylan. Right? And I've told the story before. I said, who better to ask, how do you remember all those words? How does he remember all those words? Hey, mama's in the basement, mixing up the medicine. I'm in the basement, moving on, man. Oh, look out, kid, you're gonna get hit. Don't try, man, gonna steal one again. You better walk down the alleyway, digging out a movie. As a matter of fact, my mother's here tonight. I remember when my mother first heard Bob Dylan, and she said, whoa, he can't sing. Yeah, listen to the words. So I figure he would know how you remember all these words. So I go to see Bob Dylan, and I'm in Milan, Italy. And Bob Dylan is doing a concert in Milan. So I said, I'm going to go ask Bob about this word thing. So I go to this place, and in Italy, they don't have, like, basketball arenas or hockey arenas. They have, like, bicycle dromes. You know, these awful old places from the 20s and the 30s. They're wooden, and they're creaky, and the dressing rooms Bob playing in this bicycle drome, you know, in Milan. So I go backstage, and I say, hey, hi, you know, Mr. Dylan? And he goes, hey, Billy, how you doing? And I said, look, I want to ask you, because you wrote, like, more words than there are. How do you remember all the lyrics? And he goes, well, that's easy. Just go over and take a look on the coffee table. And there in this moth-eaten dressing room is this book on the coffee table, store-bought, Bob Dylan, Greatest Hits, Volume 1, Volume 2. And I said, all right, well, if he can do it, then I'm going to try to do it. So I have this book, and it's on stage with me when I play. I'm not reading the lyrics. It's like Linus's security blanket. I'm just psychologically comforted to know that they're there in case I get in trouble. In case I need a hand, they're there. It's not like I, you know, like the little tiny print on these things. And if I lose my place, it's not like I can dive right into the right sentence, you know. So anyway, I haven't even played this since '86. I think. I hope this is the right key. It's time for me to be on my way. I know I've got business to conduct and I've got places to go. But I can't help looking at her sleeping instead. Another morning I like trouble climbing out of this bed because she's such a temptation. It's driving me crazy, and it's my fascination that's making me feel this way. I know what all of my friends say, they're afraid that I'm losing my touch, but she's such a temptation. Now that song is about having a baby. That's about having a little tiny baby in the house. Okay? You don't have to... No, I'm not gonna do the whole thing. And that song was, you know, was written about my daughter. So it came naturally. Sure, it's natural to write about my daughter. It's natural to write about a relationship you're having with somebody. But people, you don't know everything about me because of what I wrote. I don't tell you everything, you know. I don't talk about my technique and certain things, you know. I don't talk about how I screwed up so much or, I was told a long time ago, write what you know. Write what you know. So, as you go through life, you know a lot of stuff. It's just recognizing that you know it. And my favorite writers have always been people who actually write like what they know, like a guy like Pete Hamill, who writes what he knows. So to write a song about my daughter, you know, you're probably talking about The Lullaby is the one you're thinking about, right? Now that started out, okay, as a piece of classical music. A lullaby, but without words. Now, to me, even without the words, it's got a lullaby aspect to it. So, if I'm understanding your question correctly, you want to know if I find it easy to write about. You had mentioned Long Island and places I know. Okay, all right. Fair question. I think essentially the question is, did I want to write about that before I actually started to write? I don't know what I'm going to write about before I write. I write the music first. I'll give you another example. I'm going to use this thing. This is a
Kurzweil synthesizer,
and I really don't know how to use it. So I just push buttons, and I hope that shit happens. Yeah, I wrote that about 19. So anyway, I wrote this piece that went like this. It's so much like a Mozartian classical. And then I thought about it, you know, variations on a theme. I could just see handing that into the president of Columbia Records, you know? You know, I was doing this album, it's called An Innocent Man. It was kind of an homage to the music of the early 60s. When I was coming to age as a teenager, as an adolescent, it was all this early R&B and soul music and Motown, all the music that I like. But I had this piece and I said, what am I gonna do with this? And it lent itself to this. Doom, 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 ba doom, doom, ba doom, ba ba. If you say, remember, as a matter of fact, they did that to you know the Mozart piece that goes. Well, there was a piece that said, "Somewhere my love waits for me." They put words to a Mozart piece, which really took. But I thought, well, why don't I do that? You know, do this a cappella thing. Whoa, for the longest time. You know, and that's how it got written. So I wrote the music first, but the whole job of the writing was looking at the music and saying, what is this saying?
tonight, there would still be music left to write. I got it now. I'm hot now. And you catch it. So it's really decoding what is in the music. But think of it this way. Any instrumental music you hear, any classical music you hear, listen to, well, I did it before. Wait a minute. How do I find that thing again? This is where it gets into math here. Ha! Worked. I figured out how to do this. Okay. What does that mean? It lasted 200 years. What does it mean? It's this enigma, but everybody digs it when they hear it. Wow, something is going on. Now, to me, it means destiny knocking at the door. Beethoven wrote this music, and when you look at the historical context, he wrote it in, it was the French Revolution. They chopped up off the heads of all these bastards who had kept the people down for so long. He went to Europe. They knocked off all the crown heads. Everything was changing. Equality, liberty, fraternity, brotherhood. Let's remake the world. And Beethoven was writing at this time. It's very passionate stuff. So. Shit's going on. You know, the inspiration for this, musicians get inspiration from all kinds. Sometimes I'm on a subway train, right? Or on the Long Island Railroad when it's working, you know? And I'm sitting there and it's going, and musicians do that. So this, who knows, it was the landlord knocking on the door going, "What's with the rent?" Maybe the old lady downstairs with the broom, "Stop with the noise." So it's really the music. It's essentially, it's the music that gets this stuff written for me. Now, I can't say the same thing about everybody else. There's one song that I wrote that I wrote the words first that I can think of. There may be others that I have done that I can't remember. But here, let me give you an example. This is a song where I wrote the words first. And you'll see how musically profound this is. So, you know, it's like a mosquito. I don't know how other people do it. Elton gets sheaves of lyrics sent to him from Bernie Taupin. He has these lyrics. And then he goes and writes the music. I can't do it. I do it the other way around. I write the music first. So music comes very, very natural to me. I grew up in a musical family. My mother was singing all the time. My father played the piano. There was always music playing on the radio, on the record player. So that's my first language. Before I could talk, I was going, "Na, na, na, na." Right, Mom? My mom will vouch for this. Okay. Let me ask another question. The lights will come up now on cue. There's a little delay in the light thing, but that's not his fault. It's okay, all the way in the back, the furthest away, lousiest seat probably in the whole place. Okay, yes, you doing all these Hawaiian moves. Yes, that would be, okay, let's see if this works. Oh, wait, it doesn't work.
Hello.
Yeah, there you go.
I'm really glad that your mom is here and you mentioned her influence And I wonder if you would just elaborate that a little more, your family's influence on your music and their support and what got you into it and that kind of thing.
Okay. My mother is someone who came from a family that was an English family. They came from England. Of course, English people usually do. My mother's here now, so I'm getting all nervous. I better get this right, you know? And they moved here early in the 20th century, before she was born, and moved to Brooklyn, and she grew up in Brooklyn. And, okay.
Yo, Brooklyn, yo!
And my mother has a very good musical ear. She was used to sing in where she went to school, which was at the... Did you go to school there? You just went there to sing. You just went there to sing. CCNY. And she snuck into the chorus. She actually... You didn't even go to school there? I didn't know that. You didn't go to college? I felt so guilty because I didn't graduate high school and you went to college. So you snuck into the chorus. Huh? They needed an alto. Okay. So she was very familiar with Gilbert and Sullivan. She would sing in a lot of the Gilbert and Sullivan productions at CCNY. But she was familiar with classical music. I think her family just listened to classical music on the Victrola, on the radio. So I grew up hearing this. This music from a very early age, from the earliest age. Now, when I was a little kid, we had a piano in the house. It wasn't a big 9-foot Steinway piano. It was an upright Lester. You ever hear of a Lester? The Lester Piano Company? Exactly. It was a Lester. Yep. An upright Lester piano. So here I am, and I'm, you know, 3 years old, and I'm walking, I'm going, and my mother took that for a couple of years. She said, okay, that's enough of that. Hey, you're gonna bang that thing. You're going to learn how to bang it right. And she dragged me down the street. I still remember this, Mom. I'm still a little mad about it. Sir. To the piano teacher, Mrs. Neiman, whose first name was Francis, but we called her Miss Francis. Do you know who this is? Did you take lessons from this woman? She also taught ballet. Now, in my neighborhood, if you walk with books under your arm to the ballet teacher, it's like asking for kick me. It's like I'm a kick me sign. And in my neighborhood's like, yo, Billy, where's your tutu? No, Dickie McWill would bust my chops. Billy, come over here. I want to talk to you. Bang, 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 bang. So I had to learn how to fight because I had to learn how to play. You know, it was a weird, very strange existence. So now I learned how to play the piano. Now my father and my mother split when I was still fairly young, but my mother kept me going on the piano lessons. I don't know how she did this because in those days, this is an intelligent woman. It's hard to get a good job. I hope things are changing for women because in those days, she couldn't get... They wouldn't give her good work. She had to take any kind of job. She could bookkeeping, secretarial, you know, whatever she could get. But she kept paying for the piano lessons. So, what am I saying? I'm not going to say, no, I don't want to practice the piano. My mother's, you know, busting her chops to get me, you know, to pay for the piano lessons. So I'm taking the lessons. Now, when I first started, I started with John Thompson. Anybody here know the John Thompson piano course? The John Thompson books. The first piece I ever learned was the John Thompson piece number one called Off We Go to Music Land. You know, it had a little picture of a kid, you know, going off to music land. It even had words. Off we go to music land. I don't remember the second verse. Come with me and hold my hand, something like that, okay. So that was the first thing I learned. And then I kind of got into this. I had a feel for this thing. I kind of liked this stuff. So like 4, 5, 6, 7, I'm practicing, I'm reading the dots, I'm being a good kid about it. I start to get bored. I'm starting to get bored out of my skull. So instead of reading the music that the teacher would give me, I would start making up my own. And my mother knew what this music was supposed to sound like. So say I've got a Mozart piece. She's just going to be finding this out now. I'm going to hear about this. Okay, so I would have to learn the Mozart Sonata number 1 in C, okay, which I told you before. It goes like this. Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so I didn't want to read the dots. So I decided I'm going to make up my own Mozart. And let's see what happens. So I'd learn a left hand, which is... But I wouldn't play what he wrote in the dots. I'd go... And my mother would go, learning that one pretty quick. And I had to make it sound like Mozart because she knew what Mozart was supposed to sound like. So I go, oh yeah, this one's really easy. Now the next day, I'm supposed to be practicing. I don't remember what I played before. So the next day I would play. And she'd go, what was that? I say, the second movement. Now, and you know, I'd be going along the third day. I didn't remember what I played the second day, so I'd go. She goes, how many movements does this thing have? I say, well, it's, you know, one of those the teacher's trying to get me to progress a lot. So I'd get to the end of the week, and I'd bring the piece to the piano teacher and she'd say, okay, now show me how well you learned the piece you were supposed to learn. The Mozart Sonata, number 1. I'd go like this. And she'd slam the book. She'd, your mother is wasting her money. Worthless piece of slime. And I'd think, and I wrote all this other shit. I wish you could hear the stuff I wrote, you know. And I went for a couple of years, and I kind of glided along. So I didn't really pay attention to the lessons. And but I did keep writing and writing and writing because my mother was in the other room listening, paying good money for me to, like, become a really great bullshit artist, you know? Which is what a lot of writing really is. It's a lot of making stuff up. And at the, she may not have known it, and I may not have known it, but at the time, that's what I was doing. I was creating. I was making up music. And I kind of fell out of wanting to know how to be a pianist for a while until then I got to be 12, 13, 14, and I discovered girls. And I was never really like the Cary Grant type. I was never going to look like, you know, Mr. Cool. I just didn't have the great pompadour, you know, the big pompadour they used to have. And I didn't have the great, you know, clothes of the time, which, you know, the greaser clothes. You had to go to Larry's Shirt Shop at Andrews. So I would go to a party, and all the cool guys and the good-looking guys would be, you know, sweet talking the girls, hey, let's dance. And I wasn't a good dancer, and maybe so I'd kind of sneak off into another room at some party. And if they happened to have a piano there, I would just, like, all by myself, I just sit down, I start playing the piano. Look up, and there was a girl. I look up, and there was another girl. And I think to myself, this thing is incredible. So that got me into being into rock and roll bands. And to my mother's credit, unlike other parents I knew, of other people that I knew who were in bands, she actually encouraged me to be in a band. She, you know, she thought she liked the Beatles. You know, she liked the Rolling Stones. She liked the music I was listening to. So I owe a great deal of what I am, what I've done to my mom. So thank you. Take a bow. Take a bow, Mom. Take a bow. Take a bow. And as far as, just to finish the question, as far as my other parent, my father's influence on me, he was a great piano player. He classically trained, very strict as far as what piano playing was. One time, I started to boogie-woogie something up. I'll show you what I did. Did this. And I was just in a weird mood, and I started going... came down the stairs in one step and whacked the shit out of me. And he hit me so hard, he knocked me out. And, well, but I laid there and I said, and he had never really said much about my piano lessons, but when I woke up, I said, well, that got his attention. but he, you know, he also had an influence on me, just it's in the genes. Okay, so let me take another question. So I was all the way back there, over here in the Abraham Lincoln assassination area. The Ford's Theater section. Okay. Can you light them any better? Because it's very hard for me to pick somebody out of this waving mass of humanity here. Okay. Right there on the corner. I don't know if you know that you're on a corner, but it appears to me that you're on... Yeah, okay. How do we get a mic to them? Did you get it? Did they get it? Did they get it? Oh, cool. Look at that. Okay. Good technique, man.
On? Okay. There's a lot of wonderful people here to see you tonight, and I know you said you write one part of the music before you do the other. Could you maybe write a little something for your audience this evening? Sing a little bit? One for us?
Probably not.
You know, just thought I'd ask.
Okay. You understand? I can't write in front of all these people. I gotta like be alone. I'm usually like in a bathrobe and like, you know, like grungy and walking around the house kicking things. Like, you don't want to be around me when I'm writing. Trust me, I get grouchy and cranky, and I'm in a lousy mood. Until I get it, boy, somebody claps, they know this firsthand. And another thing, to be honest, I don't write thinking about an audience. I can't second guess what it is you would like to hear. I can't write thinking about, what do my fans want to hear next? You know? And I don't even like the word fans, because it makes you all like this nameless, faceless blob of fandom, you know? You know, yeah, I'm assuming you're all individual people, and if you like what I do, you must have, you know, your own individual intellect, you know? So I don't think about an audience. I can't think about an audience. If I started thinking about,
7 million people bought the last album, so I'll direct this next album towards those same 7 million people.
I don't do that. Who can do that? Or I don't write for radio. Who the hell knows what they're going to play on the radio? I don't write for the record company. I don't write for critics. I don't write for, you know, whoever. I write for me. It's purely for my own silly enjoyment. But it's whatever moves me. But let me give you some insight into how I do write. Okay.
Hello.
It works. Okay. I'm gonna play something on this synthesizer. It's not an orchestra. It's not a string section. And it's not gonna be exactly how it's supposed to sound. I'll give you an example. I realized I've always been trying to write like the composers I always admired. I was driving along in my car. I was living in Huntington at the time. I was driving on Route 110, which can be a pain in the ass to drive on. And it was like around, it was in the springtime, it was around Easter time, which is one of those holy times of year, you know? So it's raining, and the sky is cloudy and really gloomy, and I'm driving in my car, and I hear this music, and it goes like this. Now this is a piece of music called the Adagio for Strings. It's one of the saddest pieces of music ever written. It was written by a composer named Samuel Barber. It's so sad, they played it the night that Franklin Delano Roosevelt died. Now, I had heard this music before, but I never listened, really tuned into it. So I'm driving, I'm sitting on 110. What else am I gonna do except tune into the radio, because the bastard in front of me is going about 5 miles an hour, right? Now, they used this piece of music in The Elephant Man, the movie The Elephant Man, and in Platoon. They used it because it's so sad. Da, na, 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 and it builds, and it builds, and it builds. And I'm shortcutting and I'm not playing it right. And it ends on this, it doesn't end, it builds to this peak. And as it gets to that peak, the sun shoots out of the clouds, and it stops raining, and I get to, like, I cross over 25A, and the traffic clears up. I had to pull over. Right? And I pull over to the side of the road, and I burst out crying. And I said, "What's happening to me?" I lost control. I just lost it. What happened? And I realized that this is what I love about music. This is what I want to do. This is what I want to create. This is what I've always tried to create. And if you get a chance to go to a store and find this piece of music, you may not be classical music fans, but if you ever really just want to get yourself totally bummed out, and because sometimes it's okay. Get the Adagio for Strings, and that's the kind of thing that I want to write, and I hope before I can't write anymore that I create music like that. So that's as close as I'm going to be able to explain it to you. So let me take another question. Let's and the lights come up. Maybe I should play a song, right? Play a song. What do you want to hear? Okay.
They say that these are not the best of times, but they're the only times I've ever known. And I believe there is a time for meditation in cathedrals of our own. Now I have seen that sad surrender in my lover's eyes, and I can only stand apart and sympathize. For we are always what our situations hand us. It's either sadness or euphoria. Realize that nothing's ever changed. For all our mutual experience, our separate conclusions are the same. Now we are forced to recognize our inhumanity. Our reason coexists with our insanity. And though we choose between reality and madness, it's either sadness or euphoria. There's a sax solo here, so I can't do that. How thoughtlessly we dissipate our energy. Don't fulfill each other's fantasies. And as we stand upon the ledges of our lives with our respective similarities, it's either sadness or euphoria. Thank you. Yeah. Once in a while, I should do that, right? But it definitely feels weird. You know, I miss Liberty hitting the drums and singing his version of the lyrics at me, you know. She got the house, she got the car. You know, I miss that. Okay, so while I'm trying to think of a song like I could write for this pain in the ass question over here. Let's see. Oh, C.W.Post. You're the most. Maybe I'll write a country song about, you know, a C.W.Post. Let's see, you're in New York. C.W.Post, great Caesar's goes, I drink a toast, C.W., nah, that sucks. It actually sounds like a country western singer, though, doesn't it? Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Grand Ole Opry, C.W.Post. Well, thank you, you know. My name's C.W.Post.
Is this on? We on? This thing on? It's not on? No, it's good because I suck on this thing. Howdy. Well, it's nice to see y'all here tonight. This isn't tuned. Well, you know when you see me on stage with the guitar that the sound guy's got those knobs pulled way down like this.
Well, I went into town the other night to see if I could start a fight. I felt so mean that I was going nuts. Well, I felt so downright mean, you see, that when some dude bumped into me, I went and stuck a pitchfork in his guts. Thank you very much. Don't break my heart, my achy breaker.
Okay, let me take another question. Okay, so I went to the Abe Lincoln area. Okay, now I'm sure you want your shot too, right? Okay, it was that side that they got him on, I think. Okay, yes, you right there. Yeah. Now you have to kind of throw the microphone. Let's see how good you are. Now it's an expensive microphone. Don't drop it. Whoa!
Hello.
Hello.
Hey, Billy, honey. Anyway.
Hi.
God, it's so good to see you. Anyway, out of all the music that you play and deal with, classical, jazz, blues, country, what is your passion when you're sitting home by yourself, 2 o'clock in the morning? What moves you more than anything else? Hey, that's a good one.
It isn't always music, you know.
Well, we can talk about that later.
Sometimes music is background for other things. Although I hate to use it as wallpaper. Let's see. What do I like do? What do I do when I'm by myself and I just want to, like, get charged up and what do I enjoy? Okay, I'll show you what I do. I could do this. Let me go to this thing. I get a kick out of this thing. Sometimes I give myself a concert and I think, ha ha, people pay money for this. And ha ha, I'm getting this for free and I'm going to play longer than I usually play. Ha 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 ha. You know? And there's nobody there, and my cat's walking around like, does they stop with this noise already? What do I do? I'll play like play all this classical music that I only know, like, by ear. I got it. I did this. Okay, come on. I don't even know how to speak German. Just go on and on and on, and I think I'm doing this so great. And like my piano teacher was there, like she was there with an automatic rifle shooting me, you know. But it's my version of this stuff, and I little by little, I start to get it. And that's what I do. I actually, you know, I play ersatz, my version of classical music. And I got this synthesizer, and I got all these speakers, and it goes through this big living room that I got that I don't live in. Does anybody live in their living room, actually? It's one of those rooms nobody uses. The useless room. But and that's what I do. I play this kind of stuff, you know, like. I stand up and I go. But I'm getting a kick out of it, so that's what I do. But and I sometimes I do it with no clothes on. All right, let me get another question here. Okay, as the lights come up. All right, now I haven't been like to the general area for a while, so I should kind of. Where haven't I been for a while? Well, I know I haven't been there, but I was in the front row though. So let's be democratic here. How about like back here, right in the middle, like right in the middle? Yeah. Okay. Fine. Sure. Yeah. Okay. Take credit for everybody else. It's okay.
I just want to. Hello.
It's on. Don't mess with it.
Oh. Okay.
Okay.
It's nice having this conversation with you.
Thank
I think you should try to make a post-football game. And I just wanted to ask you, I know that if I made it pretty big one day, likely to do with my career, but it's to know if there was anybody that you look back that you might not have particularly liked or cared for, whether it be a distant relative or somebody you went to school with, and somebody that you've enjoyed to kind of remind them how well you've done to it. Kind of.
Okay, yeah, that's a good question. You know what, I'm glad you asked that because sometimes, and it's not that, there's nothing good about revenge. Okay, no, there really isn't, but it's a great motivation sometimes. Maybe that's the only upside to, like, I remember when I was saying I was gonna be a musician, a lot of friends of mine who were, I thought were friends of mine, the gang I was hanging out, people was hanging out, was, you're nuts. When are you going to get a real job? You can't do that. You're never going to make it. There's all these other big names. You're going to bomb out. You're never going to make it. You got to get a real job. And I didn't particularly hate them for saying that. I thought they were right. Because at the time, going into, you know, the music world was like, you know, joining some kind of, you know, alien expedition. You never knew what planet you were going to end up on. This was back in the 60s, and although I had the support of my family, really it was one of those gray areas. You never knew where you were going to end up. So once in a while, I would run across one of these, you know, people that I used to hang out with at a gig. You know, I started gigging, and I started doing well, and then I had like a hit record, and then they would end up coming back and say, remember me? You know, Vinny Gabanzalunzio from, you know, I was right in Winter Lane, right down the street from you, Winter Lane. And I said, oh yeah, okay, yeah, Vinny, I remember him, bring him back. And he go, hey, Billy, can we talk for a second? We got to talk for a second. So I said, yeah, what's the matter? He goes, Billy, listen, can you lend me like $50,000? And I'd say, Vinny, I tell you what, when I get a real job, we'll talk about it. So, but do I like enjoy the fact that there were people who I might not have liked? I was one of those stupid people. I liked everybody. You know that song? What's that show, Mom? That's it. Barney? No. It's Most Happy Fella, right? There's a character, I like everybody that I ever met. I never met anybody that I haven't liked yet. Now, you go into the music business like that, and it's like, you know, right.
you know, I trust you, I like you, I like everybody, everybody's nice, I like everybody. Sometimes it's okay not to like people because there's some real bums out there. But I liked everybody, so I really, there wasn't really anybody I hate. I'm trying to think, who did I not like that I'm really happy that, like, I'm like this rich rock star now? I'm trying to think. Is that, that was basically, that was the question. Yes, yeah, like, who do I really feel like? Nah, there really isn't anybody that I dislike that much, and I don't really feel like that. I don't feel like that. I just don't feel like that. Don't get me wrong, this is an incredible job I got. It's a very good job, and I'm very happy to have it. Okay, so let me, all right, go over here. Okay, this guy right here. No, the guy right next to him. Oh. Hey, now he's all disappointed. All right, you know what? You can ask right after him, all right? Give me the whinge thing, you know?
Thanks. Thank you, Billy. Thank you.
Okay.
When I was in high school, I was studying to be an actor. One of the problems I had with being an actor, my only fright was singing. Still not very good at it, but a certain teacher got me the courage to finally start singing in front of an audience. It was Mr. Arnold.
Oh, Chuck Arnold, yeah. Good teacher.
Hicksville?
Yes.
He was a big influence on me to get me to start singing. I don't really do much acting, but I consider him one of the most influential people in my high school, during my high school days. And I give him a lot of credit for, like you said with girls, it was the same thing with acting. And I, all the successes I had in high school.
Why else did we do anything?
That's pretty much true. My question to you is, was he influential to you in any way?
Okay, he's mentioning a teacher that was in my high school. I went to Hicksville High School, and I wasn't showing up for school a lot, and I just couldn't. I was working till 3 o'clock in the morning. You know, look, we're in New York. Clubs stay open 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock. People want to hear music. You play the music. 7 o'clock. I couldn't. Who could get up at 7 o'clock for what? For gym? You know, I gotta get up for gym. Oh man, I gotta go. 7 o'clock. I'm gonna miss gym. So sometimes I wouldn't go. I'm sorry, Mom. So, Chuck Arnold, he was a teacher. He actually said to me, he heard me playing. I'll show you what I was doing when I met Chuck Arnold. Okay. I was playing one of my ersatz. Classical kind of, you know the Tchaikovsky piano concerto that goes da 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 bum, da 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 da. I was cutting a class, and I was in playing. They had this big grand piano in the auditorium, and I'm making believe that I'm Van Cliver. Obviously, I don't know how to play this thing. But this guy comes over and taps me on the shoulder. He goes, "You don't really know how to play this, do you?" And I said, "No." And he goes, "That was one of the greatest, like, snow jobs I've ever heard." And it was Chuck Arnold. He says, "I want you to be in my music class." And it ends up, it was like a great class for me because it was called music appreciation. It was really music history. And I knew all these things about history, and I knew all these things about music, and that class kind of put it all together for me. And then I was in the chorus. And this was a teacher who, this, you're talking about the mid-60s, said to me, "You should be a musician. You should be a professional musician." Now, for a teacher to say that, that's like condemning someone to a life of, you know, poverty, drug-taking, alcoholism, you know, and failure and ignominy, you know. "You should be a bum," is basically, he was saying, but what he said to me is, "You have all the prerequisites that are needed for a musician. You have you have a great ear, you have talent, you have this, you have that. And I thought, a teacher is telling me this. It had a huge influence on me. And I gave him credit on this album that I put out, thanks to Chuck Arnold for the inspiration. And did he tell you that you should be an actor? Or did he say, maybe you should stay with the accounting thing? He liked your acting. Yeah, he was a very good teacher. Teachers do make a difference. One of the reasons I'm doing something like this. Me too. You'll remember a good teacher for the rest of your life, and it's not just the popular teacher, but a teacher who really had an impact on you. This guy had an impact on me. And I actually wanted at one time to be a teacher. I thought about being a history teacher. I always hated the way they taught us. Well, the Civil War began in 1861. Okay, 1861. That's not what it was all about. It was like, what was this whole big important thing that happened? What was it all about? What were they wearing? What was the music they were listening to? What kind of sports did they do? What did they do in their hobbies? What did they do in their off time? What was their real life like? And they didn't teach history like that. So I wanted to be a history teacher, but then I didn't graduate high school, so there went the history teaching thing. So, yes, that teacher did have a big impact on me. Now this guy right next to you, I'll follow up.
Hello, Billy. Hi. I have a question for you concerning you and your record company. Your past two albums, there was a special release, I don't know why, of all places, in Australia. There was a special box set, and it had one disc was similar to what you're doing now,
yeah.
Plus Yankee Stadium and some songs from the Meadowlands with Elton John. I'm curious, why don't you think that it would be released here and only in Australia, of all places?
I tell you the truth, that is a decision that was made by Sony. Now, Sony is an international company. I'm on Columbia Records, but I'm also on Sony Music Entertainment. Sony is this huge international conglomerate. They have a record company in every country in the world. Sony Australia, Sony Germany, Sony Egypt, Sony Montenegro, Sony Bosnia, Sony, you name it, there's a Sony company there. And they will come to me and ask me to put out certain types of things. And now this is stuff that I've already recorded. There was actually an interest from the Australian record company for me to take one of these. I think it was at Princeton University. I did one of these things at Princeton, and Australia said, yeah, Billy, we'd like to have that on an album that we can put out here in Australia. So I said, really? Like, what, do you have like a death wish or something? Like, nah, we really think it'd really get in great, there's a great demand for it, Billy, and we want to put it out. So I said, if you guys have the nerve to put this out, then go right ahead. And it was actually their concept. Now, if the American company wanted to do that, I'd say fine. But I can't go over there and like force them to do it. I could probably pressure them, because like I said, I want to put out this thing, okay? And they'll go, oh, okay, yeah, sure, it's a great idea, man, yeah. Yeah, no, we really think it'll be a big hit here. Yeah, right. It's like, if they're not going to get behind it, if they're not going to promote it, if they're not going to market this thing, then I don't want to make them do it. So I'm waiting for them to say to me that they'll want to do it. Now, you got it, you heard this, it was available on an import? Well, so then the Australian Sony makes more money than the American Sony company. And so there's guys who thought it was a great idea, really, I'm looking really good to the people who own Sony, And that's how it works, believe it or not. So, I'm not opposed to putting it out here, but I don't know. Would it mean anything? I guess maybe it's more important on an import. I've heard some great stuff on imports that you can't get in the States. There was even House of Blue Light. That was a B-side to some other single, but it was never on an album. It wasn't that good, anyway. Nah, it wasn't that good. But, okay, let me go to another question here. Okay, yes, the frantic waving person right here. I will get to the back of the room. I'm sorry I haven't been back there for a while. I will get back. Are those cheaper seats, by the way?
No, it's all one price? Nobody bought any scalped things for this. Okay, that's good. Okay.
Billy, who are your muses? What inspires you to keep being Billy Joel after all these decades?
What inspires me to keep Billy Joel? Well, to keep being Billy Joel? Well, number one, I really don't have any other choice. I think I'm somewhat, I don't want to say schizophrenic, but I have these different hats I put on. I read an interview once about Jimi Hendrix, who I love. It was my idol. I think Jimi Hendrix was a genius. Some days, and Jimi Hendrix said, some days I wake up and I'm a cowboy. Some days I wake up and I'm an astronaut. Some days I wake up and I'm an Indian warrior chief. Some days I wake up and, and I'm a fireman. Every day he was whatever he was that day. And I feel a little bit like that. I happen to feel a little bit like when Hendrix said, as soon as I read that about him, I said, wow, that's incredible. I never saw that written. I never saw anybody say that. I don't really know exactly who this Billy Joel guy is. A lot of times, I don't even want to be Billy Joel. Some days I want to be Ray Charles, you know? And so I'll give you an example.
Some folks like to get away, take a holiday from the neighborhood, have a flight to Miami Beach or to Hollywood. Me, I'm taking a Greyhound on the Hudson River line. I'm in a New York state of mind.
Now that day I felt like Ray Charles. If I had said, well, let's see, I'm gonna write a song about where I come from as Billy Joel. Levittown. Yes, it's Levittown. There's not much going down in Levittown. Oh, the dirt is brown out here in that's not a bad song, actually. In Levittown. And then some days I felt like some days I feel like Hendrix, right? Let me find this. This is called, this is called the fluid guitar stop. You can actually make believe you can play guitar on this thing. This is kind of cool. Okay, watch this. You see how I stink on this one. All right, so like okay, so I write this song, right? I felt like Jimi Hendrix that day. Well, I'm shameless when it comes to loving you. I'll do anything you want me to. I'll do anything at all. Well, I'm standing here for all the world to see. Oh, there ain't that much left of me.
that has very far to fall.
You know,
I'm not a man who's ever been insecure about the world I've been living in. I don't break easy, I have my pride, but if you need to be satisfied, I'm shameless.
And I felt like I was Hendrix. I even chewed gum when I was doing, you know. What was that song you did, Little Wing?
Well, she's a walking through the cloud with a circus mind, yeah, shucks. She calls out loud.
Now, and then that song was born like to be a Jimi Hendrix song, and then this guy, Garth Brooks, did it. And it's, right? And yeah,
well, I'm shameless when it comes to loving you. I'd do anything you want me to. I'd do anything at all.
So this child that I brought into the world is, as you know, Jimi Hendrix kid grew up to be a country western star, you know. And so, you know, I'm different every day. It's I don't. What inspires me? What drives me to keep being Billy Joel? It's like I don't have a choice. I am
who I am. That's all that I am. I believe the piano man, boop, boop, you know. So.
But in truth, I like music. I love music. I was always enchanted by music. I will continue to be constantly driven to do something with music. I'm not going to try to act. This guy here, they send me scripts. I don't know, these Hollywood guys, I mean, well, we see you as this kind of Long Island kind of guy, you know, and you can be in the movie. And they sent me a script that was going to be in a movie with De Niro, and they want me to act next to Robert De Niro, you know. And here there's, like, acting students who have, like, struggled all their lives just to stand in line to get an audition. And me, I could waltz in and go, okay, I'll take the part, you know what I mean? I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to be an actor. What the hell is wrong with music? You know, so that's what I'm going to do, and that's what drives me. So, okay. Spring up the lights. Now, I said I would get to the back again. Okay. Okay, now we have a minute. Now, there's a whole rooting section over here for somebody. Who are you pointing at? All right. Whoever's got the microphone, if you can figure out who it is that they're promoting over there. Okay,
it's on. One of my favorite songs of yours is She's Right on Time. And I wonder if maybe you could sing a little bit of that for us and maybe musically, lyrically, where a little bit of where it came from.
Okay, you want me to sing it like as if this is a big piano bar thing and
Sure.
And it's he just takes requests. It's great. It's like a big piano bar. I could pass this back to you, and you know you could throw a few quid in there for. Let's see. Okay, she's right on time. Let me get the lyric to that, and I will get to you. This would be in the S section. A lot of S's. Man, there's a million S songs. It's like in a phone book. A lot of people would. Last name of S, okay. She's right on time. Okay. Okay, now I think that was like a combination. Nah, that don't sound right. Okay.
Turn on all the Christmas lights. Baby's coming home tonight. I can hear her footsteps in the street. Turn the choral music higher. Pile more wood upon the fire. That would make the atmosphere complete. I've had to wait forever, but better late than never. She's just in time for me. She's right on time. She's right where she should be. She's right on time. A man with so much tension, far too many. Oh, you know the sins part, sure. Okay, that was written, I always wanted to write a Christmas song, but I didn't want to write one of those Billy Joel Christmas album melodies, you know. I think that was kind of a wank, you know. It's a, oh, it's a 1983 Christmas. So I thought if I could just like add the element of Christmas to a song about people getting back together, and this, I think this was written while I was still married to X1. And I was, you know, hoping that that was going to work out. It didn't, but you always hope that it does. And I was actually the...
Turn on all the Christmas lights.
I'll tell you who I was trying to sing like. It was a, one of my favorite singers of all time. This goes back to 1969.
Come down off your throne and leave your money alone. Somebody must change. You are the reason I've been waiting all these years. Somebody holds a key.
It was a guy named Steve Winwood.
Think about it.
He had a recent hit.
There must be higher love on a bit. Whatever the words are, I don't know.
And so I was trying to sing like Steve Winwood, who was another guy who wants to sing like Ray Charles. And it's amazing, there's all these white guys running around who want to sing like Ray Charles. Like, okay, one of my favorite bands in the 70s was Led Zeppelin. Right?
I've been dazed and confused for so long, it's not true. Why did a woman ever bargain for you? Oh, baby, baby, baby.
And I met Robert Plant. He's a skinny little English guy with blonde hair. And I, how did you come up with that vocal style?
Well, I was trying to sing like Ray Charles.
I met Rod Stewart, right? I'm on the road. There's Rust.
Wake up, Maggie, I think I got something to say to you.
Sounds like he's got a sore throat all the time.
It's late September and I really should be back at school.
I said, how can you sing like that? He goes,
well, I'm trying to sing like Ray Charles.
Steve Winwood, trying to sing like Ray Charles. Joe Cocker.
Scaring through the bathroom window. Pretending I sell a spoon.
And I asked Joe Cocker, I said, how did you get that great? He's from Wales. People don't sing like that in Wales. It's like right next to England.
So it's like bells them.
Why do you sing that? And to hear Joe talk regular and stuff.
I'm sorry if I was just telling you it's Ray Charles.
And this all, this Ray Charles has got all these guys to sing like this. So I wanted to sing a song like that and introduce an element of Christmas. And that's really where it came from. That's a long answer to a really short question. This fan isn't doing it. It's like having a German Shepherd breathe on me. I mean, we don't ask for much. Mac, where's Max? Do we ask for much in the rider? I'd like a little water backstage. Right, some like bad deli meat would be okay. And a fan.
Wait a minute, it's on.
Now we're talking. Okay, let me take another question here. So I went all the way to the back. I haven't been to this area for a while. Oh, the guy who actually took his shirt off to get attention. Typical obnoxious Long Island cheap trick, right?
Billy, it's an honor to be able to talk with you. I'm an obnoxious Jew from New Jersey, actually. I'm not really obnoxious. I just wanted to get your attention. I just wanted to say I saw an interview with you once, and you were asked how you got out of writer's block, and you said you pretend you're a composer, and you get into character, and you say, and you put on a writing suit. Man, I'm so nervous. I'm talking to you. And
he's got his shirt off, and he's nervous.
And,
you're doing fine. You're doing really well.
Thanks. And I just want to say, I had writer's block. I was working on this song for months, and I was fed up with not finishing it. So I don't have the money for a writer's suit, but I did buy a bottle of wine, like you said you do. And actually, I found out I didn't have a corkscrew. I don't drink a lot. But just getting into character worked, and I wrote a bridge, and I want to thank you for your advice, although you didn't give it directly to me.
Thank you. Therefore, the question would be, don't shut him off yet. I don't think he really got to the question.
Yeah, oh, sorry. I guess, do you always just try to get into character when your own life doesn't inspire you, or?
Okay, how do you get through writer's block?
Yeah.
How do you deal with it? Okay, fair question. A lot of times I'm stuck writing. I don't always know how to get something going. I'm one of those people who is a cold start writer. It's like this winter trying to start your car, okay? This is one of them nasty winters. Some people write all the time. Stevie Wonder writes all the time. He writes a song a day. He even says that. When you meet him, "Hi, I'm Stevie Wonder. I write a song a day." And I love Stevie Wonder. I think he's a genius. But, you know, I met him and he says, "Hi, I'm Stevie Wonder. And I write a song a day." And I thought, well, giddy, giddy, giddy for you. Like, I bet you we ain't gonna hear a lot of the lousy songs, you know, like, because that would mean you'd have an album with 365 songs on it. So, but he does that to stay in the mode. Now, some writers do that. There are some, it's like novelists. Stephen King knocks out one of these bestsellers every 6 months. This Pet Sematary, and the one about the car, and he's like the most productive. How does he come up with this stuff every 6 months? He's got to be a very sick man, you know? But fertile, and, you know, he's brilliant. He just keeps going. And then there's a writer like J.D. Salinger, who wrote 3 books, you know? But they're incredible books, and maybe he doesn't want to write any more than that. Maybe he's not inspired to write any more than that. So you've got to find your tempo. There may be times where you're hot and you're right, and there's sometimes when you're not. And if you try to write, you try to force it, and you know it's not any good, and you drive yourself crazy, and you're banging your head against the wall, sometimes it's good to just walk away and say, not right now, not right now. Even the greatest athletes who have all the fundamentals sometimes go into a slump. They just have a bad year. They're just not putting it together. They can't hit. And they, you know, they'll go to psychics, or they'll do transcendental meditation. What was that movie with Bull Durham, when he wore the woman's underwear? He was trying to do anything, you know, to break the slump. Sometimes it's just not going to work, and it's good to recognize that maybe you shouldn't try.
But if too much time goes by and you haven't tried, you got to get back on the horse and ride again. And the thing that you're talking about was sometimes, and I don't know if you've heard this, if I get writer's block, what I used to do when I lived in Manhattan, I would go down to like some little joint in Little Italy or some, a little cafe downtown, a little in the Village. And I would dress like Chopin-esque. You know, I would wear like a nice long overcoat, and I'd No. I was going to make a point. This is Max, my tour manager. And I put on a scarf. I try to look very 19th century writer-y. And I go, and I sit at the table, and I have a glass of wine at the table, and I have my notebook with me, and I didn't have a clue what I was going to write. But I would look like a writer, you know? I would just look real writer-y. You know, I'd have my scarf, and I would have my brow all furrowed, and my pen would be arcing above the page, and the waiters would be going, "Oh, it's Mr. Joel is writing," you know, and they were all thinking that I was writing, and then they would, the people in the restaurant would be going, "This is Billy Joel writing," and I would hear and I would think, "Yeah, that's right, I am writing." That's right, I'm a writer. I can write. They all think I'm writing. I'm gonna write. And I would delude myself into thinking that I'm gonna actually write something. And what I found was, if you think you can, a lot of times you can. You know, it's how it seems to work. If you think you can't, you won't. But if you think if you can psych yourself up to do it somehow or other. But this isn't like psyching yourself to get up on a stage in front of a performance. Some people ask me, they say, "How do you get psyched to go on stage at Madison Square Garden?" It's like, who needs to get psyched? You know, you walk from this quiet little dressing room, and you go on the stage, and 20,000 people go, "Ah!" And like, your nerves go, and your hair on your arms stands up. "I'm psyched now, man, I'm psyched." You know? You don't need to get psyched for that. Because that's when, how do you get up for a show? Get up for a show. And I see Henley. Henley's on a treadmill before he goes out on stage. 30 minutes, he's running on a treadmill. I said, "What the hell are you doing?" He goes, "Well, I want to get warmed up. I don't want to go out there cold." I said, "Well, whatever you need, man." And there's some people who do these vocal exercises. I don't do anything. And there's Sting, he's backstage doing his meditation thing. You know, he's into yoga and stuff. Whatever it takes, and he's into this. He said he can have sex for 8 hours, right? You read that? You hear about that on Sting? Sex for 8 hours. I don't want to have sex for 8 hours. So last time I saw him, I said, "Why don't you give me this, like, the 60-minute version of this, you know?" So, but whatever it is you need to do to get through writer's block, sometimes you got to push it, and sometimes know when to say, it just ain't happening now. I won't punish my, what's that Stuart Smalley? "But that's okay." Gosh darn it, people like me. Okay, let me take another question. Okay. Let me go middle ground here. Okay, right here. Yeah, right here. Yes, the very frantic. No. Her, okay. So. Okay, does it work?
I don't.
Yeah, you just speak forcefully.
I would have taken my shirt off, but I'm with my parents, so I don't think that's a good idea.
Oh, that really gives them a great deal of comfort, I'm sure.
I just.
So next time you guys aren't around.
So sorry about that. Okay. I'll leave them home next time. I just wanted to say I think you're a brilliant songwriter.
Thank you.
I'm nervous tonight too. I wanted to say, I think you look really good tonight. And I was wondering if you were free after the show.
That's the question?
Absolutely. I've been waiting all night to ask you that.
Okay, no, I'm not free after the show. I'm sorry.
Oh, you're breaking my heart.
Sorry. No, I have a date. I have a date. Sorry. That was it? That was the question? What am I doing after the show? I got to go back to New York because I got to do something in New York tomorrow. And then I'm going to go home after that. But I do have someone that I'm seeing and on. How else do I answer that? What am I? Okay, let me go. Okay, let's go to the front row. I haven't been in the front row a long time. Okay.
Hi, Billy.
Hi.
What was I gonna say? There's.
All right, we've been to 5 of your concerts, and we paid an extraordinary amount of money just for you.
I'm sorry.
All right, I just want. We've been to 5 of your concerts here last year.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. We just want to know if there's anything you feel you can do with scalpers or anything, because we don't want to lose people like you having concerts around. We don't want you to like leave and be, you know, not.
Okay. Did you hear what she said? No. Okay. I will translate in my language. She said, "Is there anything that I think I could do about scalpers? I've tried to do whatever I could do about scalpers. I try to follow up." On when I hear that people can't get seats or they got A status seats, and I know that the people who are really diehard, you know, music lovers to see anybody camp out overnight to try to get tickets, and for some reason or other, they always end up in the back. You know, they never get the front rows, right? Now, why is that? If you knew you were the first person online, the dead of winter, 3 o'clock in the morning, freezing your ass off, and you got the right color bracelet, whatever it is, and you get to the ticket window, and then they say, "Oh, we're all out of tickets for the good seats." And you go, "Bullshit." Now, that makes me as mad as it makes you mad. You may not believe that, but I really used to get angry because I knew that people were camping out trying to see us. And a lot of nights, especially in places like the L.A. Forum and a lot of these buildings that had a lot of built-in weird stuff going on, you'd look down in the front row, there are all these, you know, big fat accountants and lawyers, you know, with gold chains and, you know, sitting there. "Well, I paid $500, so entertain me, piano man, ski." You know, got the shirt open to here with the hairy chest, you know, with the woman with the big bouffant. "Well, I'm with, you know, Bruno tonight, you know. He got tickets to see Billy Joe." And I'd be playing, I'd go, "Who the hell are these people? How did they get the front row seats?" And it would happen night after night after night. And I finally got really, man, I said, "We're not going to," and it was Christmas time, and I think it was like at the Nassau Coliseum, right? And I said, "We're not going to put the first couple of rows on sale. We are going to hold those tickets, and we're going to do what we want with those tickets." So I didn't put the first couple of rows on sale. Now, I took the stage manager, is this guy named Bobby Thrasher. We call him Boomer. Big, huge guy. We dressed him up like Santa Claus, and he went to the furthest away seats in the Coliseum, people all the way in the back, and he gave them tickets to the front rows, right? Now, okay, a lot of us here were from New York. Now, you know, a New Yorker doesn't believe that anybody's going to give him anything, right? So they were like, "What do you mean you're going to give me tickets to the front? What am I supposed to do for these tickets? And where do I got to go to sit?" And I don't, you know. But eventually that's what happened. And all these kids who were the real, you know, real aficionados came down to the front row and they were going, "Ah!" You know, not like, you know, entertain me, piano man. They were like flipping out and jumping, and we had a great concert. So from then on, we never we have never put, I think if this happened in the early 80s, we've never put the first couple of rows for concerts on sale. We give the tickets to the road crew. Now, the road crew goes out and we say to the road crew, go give those tickets to the kids who have the worst seats in the house. And they used to do that most of the time. They're supposed to do that. But then a lot of times, the road crew will give tickets to, like, these cute girls that they want to meet. So we'll look down, I'll look down, and I'll see, like, these girls with, like, these little short dresses and high heels and stockings and stuff and lingerie, and I'll think, well, that's a really good-looking audience, right? You know, what's all this about? But, you know, but there are still a lot of fans who get the tickets, you know, in the back rows. Now, I go out on tour with Elton John. Now, Elton, and I say to Elton, we don't put the first couple of rows on sale so the real fans can get the tickets. So Elton thinks this is a cool idea. We keep the tickets away from the scalpers, all the good seats. We keep the good seats. We give them to the real fans. So Elton goes, cool. So the first couple of nights, he's looking over, and he sees all these cute girls over in this area. So I see a little light bulb go off over Elton's head. And for the rest of the tour, on this side of the stage, all these, like, cute boys in the front, you know? Fair is fair, you know? But I really didn't enjoy playing that side as much, you know? But don't get me wrong, you know, good looking, it doesn't hurt the show. You look down and say, they're doing this with their little leggies, you know? You go, ooh, wow, hey. So I do get tired of the larceny in the music business, though, and the scalping. It drives me crazy, and I'm not saying I'll never play again, because I will play again. Greek guy, Pan, right? Okay, thank you. Maybe I should play another song. I should play another song. No, wait. I try this song. Actually, I don't have the lyrics in this book. You know, you can't do that without a band. Unless you're gonna use some, like, Las Vegas version of it. Hey, nothing else I can do. Hey, doing it off Elena. Hey, sweetheart, you know. Let me try, this is one of those songs that we don't have the lyrics in this book for. Try to remember the lyrics to this, okay? If I screw up, please yell out what the right lyrics are, okay?
Okay.
But I think this is apropos because I'm an islander, okay?
Well, I'm on the Downeaster, Alexa. And I'm cruising through Block Island Sound. I have chanted a curse to the vineyard, but tonight I am Nantucket bound. We took on diesel back in Montauk yesterday, left this morning from the Bell in Gardner's Bay. Like all the locals here, I had to sell my home. Too proud to leave, I worked my fingers to the bone so I could own my Downeaster Alexa. And I go where the ocean is deep. There are giants out there in the canyons, and a good captain can't fall asleep. I got bills to pay and children who need clothes. I know there's fish out there, but where, God only knows. They say these waters aren't what they used to be. But I got people back online who count on me. So if you see my Downeaster Alexa, and if you work with the rod and the reel, tell my wife I am trolling Atlantis, and I still have my hands on the wheel. Shore every year. Since they told me I can't sell no stripers, and there's no luck in sword fishing here. I was a bayman like my father was before. You can't make a living as a bayman anymore. There ain't much future for a man who works the sea, but there ain't no island left for islanders like me. Yeah, 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 yo. Yeah, 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 yo. Yeah, 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 yo. Yeah, 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 yo.
Thank you. Okay, let me take one more question. It's getting late. It's going to snow this weekend, right? What else is new? Okay, right here. This guy right here. What does that say? Oh, okay. Thank you.
Hello?
Yes.
I'm curious, what's in your CD player, and what's your favorite Beatle album?
He's right. This guy's right. Okay, all right, then I got to give him one. What's in my CD player? I got one of those Sony 100 CD players. I'm lying. I actually have two of those Sony 100 CD players. Right now, it's mostly all classical music. Beethoven, Chopin, Mozart, Liszt, Brahms, Debussy, Rossini, Puccini, Linguini, Alavangale. Okay, so it's mostly classical music. What is my favorite Beatle album? That's a good question. They had so many good albums. I love Sgt. Pepper, yes. I love Sgt. Pepper, but... That's a. I've just seen. Hello, 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 hello. You can hear me, right? But I can't hear me. Am I in here? Am I in here? Hello, 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 hello. There I am. What's the. I once had a girl, or should I say, she once had me. I think my favorite Beatle album is Rubber Soul. I think it is. And this guy shares me, but I will. I'd like to play my favorite Beatles song after I take this question. Okay.
I just wondered what authors or poets you rely on if you go to writing versus composers and musicians for inspiration.
Okay. Well, I
I love to read, and I was brought up in a house that had a lot of books in it. We were always reading. We were always going to the library. We were always going to these weird, wacko bookstores. And my grandfather, my mother's father, loved poetry. He was an Englishman. He loved the Robert Burns and Shakespeare, and all that went on in my house. My favorite writer, my particular favorite writer, is probably, believe it or not, Mark Twain. He's an American writer, I think. He just, not the well-known stuff, some of the more obscure stuff, like The Mysterious Stranger, and as far as poets go, poets, Shakespeare, I think, you know, sonnets of Shakespeare. I like so many writers and poets. I haven't figured out like who my guy is because I'm not a novelist, I'm not a poet, I'm not a fiction writer, I'm not a prose writer really. I write song lyrics. My favorite poet, okay.
There once was a man from Peru.
No. I would say it would be Dylan Thomas, William Shakespeare, Blake, Robert Frost, and that group of guys. But that's a toughie. I mean, I like a lot. I love The Great Gatsby. I think that was one of the greatest books ever written by F. Scott Fitzgerald, which like was like right over here. You know what I mean? That's so cool. It's like, yeah, it was right over there, north of 25A, you know? Where all them rich people used to live, you know? And still do, actually. So, anyway, let me finish up this other thought while I'm... I think this was on that album. I think this was on the Rubber Soul album. I realized that how much I missed John Lennon. Because... This song just stays with me. There are places I remember all my life, though some have changed, some forever, not for better. Some are gone and some remain. All these places have their moments with people and things I still can recall. Some are dead and some are living. In my life, I've loved them all. But of all these friends and lovers, there is no one compares with you. And these memories lose their meaning when I think of love as something new. Though I know I'll never lose affection for people and things that went before, I know I'll often stop and think about them. My life, I love you more. I love you more. I'll never forget the first time I saw Bob Dylan wearing this thing, and I thought, what the hell is wrong with that guy's neck, man? I thought he was in some kind of traction or something, you know? Look at that guy, man. Have war and peace, the truth just is, it's come you gully glides. I found four-legged forest clouds, the cowboy angel rides.
with his candle lit into the sun, though its glow is waxed in black. All except inside the gates of Eden.
Oh, that's what it's for. Anyway, so this is the real old-fashioned one of these. Pain in the ass to get it tightened up. And from time to time, I do get my beard actually caught in the little spring part, and it hurts like hell. So it's not an emotive look I'm having. It's actual physical pain. But, clock on a Saturday, the regular crowd shuffles in. There's an old man sitting next to me, making love to his tonic and gin. He says, son, can you play me a memory? Not really sure how it goes, but it sounded sweet, and I knew it complete when I wore a younger man's clothes. La 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 di di da. La 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 di di da. Sing us a song, you're the piano man. Sing us a song. At the bar is a friend of mine. He gets me my drinks for free, and he's quick with a joke or to light up your smoke, but there's some place that he'd rather be. He says, Bill, I believe this is killing me, as a smile ran away from his face. Well, I'm sure that I could be a movie star. This place. Now Paul is a real estate novelist who never had time for a wife, and he's talking with Davy, who's still in the Navy and probably will be for life. Men slowly get stoned. Yes, they're sharing a drink they call loneliness, but it's better than drinking alone. And I just say, good crowd for a Saturday, and the manager gives me a smile, 'cause he knows that it's me they've been coming to see, to forget about life for a while. And the piano, it sounds like a carnival, and the
microphone smells like a beer. And they sit at the bar and put bread in my jar and say, man, what are you doing here? Oh, la, 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 di, di, da. La, la, di, di, da. Thank you very much. Good night.